this was my favorite lick on the tape. It was a total monster, incredibly fast, incredibly aggressive. With the combination of heavy muting and aggressive picking, it sounded like an erupting volcano. But I couldn't really see what the left hand was doing, and when I tried to slow the lick down with the SK1, this is what I got. Slop. The SK1 played everything an octave lower, and this made it too muddy to hear the individual notes. But if the tablature was correct, and I wasn't betting my life that it was, Yngwie was using an unusual left-hand pattern that moved across two strings. Now this was pretty weird. And difficult to play fast. Especially that one note on the string by itself at the end. It reminded me of the awkwardness I'd felt when I originally practiced Eric Johnson's five-note patterns. The difference was, now I knew why. It was because the whole pattern switched strings after downstrokes. This completely went against the grain of downward pickslanting, and I could feel the pick fighting the strings to do it. I went back to the video, but it was just too fast and blurry. I was all out of ideas. But just ahead on the tape, ideas were coming. The infamous A minor arpeggios. I noticed that although the left hand created different shapes as it moved up the fretboard, the picking pattern was exactly the same every time. Upstroke, pull off, upstroke, down, down, down. And then again, upstroke, pull off, upstroke, down, 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 and so on. The pickslanting was really easy to see here, and as I picked the lick apart, I began to realize just how critical it was to making the pattern work. The pattern started with an upstroke on the E string. Then Yngwie threw in a pull-off on the E string, so that the only pick note on that string was an upstroke. This made sense, because it satisfied the rules of only switching strings after upstrokes. But wait a minute. Since Yngwie was only playing two notes on the E string anyway, why didn't he just go down up? Then he could pick both notes and still finish on an upstroke. After all, this worked fine in the Black Star lick, which had two pick notes on several of its strings. It was a good question, and the answer became obvious when I looked at the next note of the arpeggio pattern. The third note of the pattern was a single note on the B string. And because it was the only note on that string, the only possible way to pick it was an upstroke. Yngwie had no choice in the matter. If he wanted to follow the rules of switching only after upstrokes, this single note had to be an upstroke. So working backward then, this meant that the previous note on the E string would have to be a downstroke in order to lead into the upstroke on the B string. But of course, that wouldn't work because that would also violate the rules. Trying to go from a downstroke on the E string to an upstroke on the B string required a big string hop, and that was definitely not going to work at high speed. Painted into a corner like this, the only possible choice for the last note on the E string was thus a pull-off. So the whole pattern so far was upstroke, pull-off, upstroke. The benefit of playing that single note on the B string with an upstroke became clear with the fourth note of the pattern. The fourth note was a downstroke on the G string, and it came so fast after the third note that the only way to do this with alternate picking was to play the third note with an upstroke. Very nicely done, and very obviously a perfect application for switching strings after upstrokes. Then, of course, there was the sweep. By the time Yngwie had swept through those three strings, his pick was back to the high E, on a downstroke. And this explained the final piece of the puzzle. Why did Yngwie start the pattern on an upstroke in the first place? Of course, because he knew he would end the pattern on a down sweep, and starting the lick on an upstroke would be the only way to connect the pattern without pausing. The way the right combination of pick strokes and pick slanting could navigate the swirling vortex of string changes, it was almost like magic. As I was practicing these shapes, I also noticed another very interesting attribute of pick slanting. It made sweeping easier. The downward slant of the pick helped the pick flop over the top of the strings. And this made sense because Yngwie was sweeping in a downward direction, the same direction as his pick slant. This made sweeping as easy as rolling downhill. It was kind of like those spikes in a parking garage. If you drive over them the right way, you slide right over. But if you drive the wrong way, the results would be deflating. And come to think of it, Yngwie only drove in one direction. When I looked at all the arpeggio licks on the tape, Yngwie only ever seemed to use downward sweeping, never upward sweeping. I decided this was clearly not an accident. Just like his single string licks, his arpeggio licks were designed specifically to work with downward pick slanting.
This is the way I use the fingering on a diminished arpeggio. It goes as follows.
The almost magical connection between pick slanting and sweeping only made it more obvious that this VHS tape was almost like the master's book of spells. The deeper you looked, the more power it contained. And the most powerful thing on the tape was still the volcano lick. I had pretty much settled on what I thought the left hand should be, and it was close, though not exactly like the tablature in the book. But it was still impossible to play. And then I had this crazy idea. What about sweeping? That didn't make any sense. Sweeping was for arpeggios, right? So I tried it. Boy, that felt weird. I tried it again. That still felt weird. That could not be what he was doing. But when I went back to look at the video, sure enough, there it was. Totally crazy. If I played three notes on a string, and I started on a downstroke, I would also end on a downstroke. Ordinarily, this caused a string hopping problem, but not for Yngwie. He could just use a downward sweep to get to the next string. In fact, when I thought about it, I could technically play a whole scale by using downward sweeping to connect each of the strings. But that was so crazy, that couldn't be what he was doing, right? But it totally was. The end of the volcano lick was a perfect example of this. It was an ascending A minor scale that completely avoided string hopping because the pick never left the strings. It just pushed right on through them. In fact, when I thought back to Now Your Ships Are Burned, I remembered a ferocious fill that Yngwie played in one of the song's many stop time breaks. I was always in awe of how fearsome and aggressive that fill sounded, and now I knew exactly how he was doing it. But what about the rest of the volcano lick? As I had originally experienced, when I tried to play the first six notes of the lick with pure alternate picking, it became a tongue twister for the right hand. The string changes all happened after downstrokes. This made the pick fight the string changes, and it didn't feel clean. But when I did it with sweeping, something fundamental changed. It made the second string change work out after an upstroke. And thanks to downward pickslanting, it became simple to hit that last note. From there, the lick continued on the A string. So what did Yngwie do? Of course, another sweep. And the sweep, in turn, allowed him to repeat the pattern on the next pair of strings. In fact, if I took the first six notes of the Volcano lick and treated them as a pattern, I could make it work out cleanly across all the strings. All the string changes were either downward sweeps or upstrokes. When I worked out the rest of the Volcano lick, what I discovered was the exact same thing: down sweeps or upstrokes the entire way. In fact, the lick ends with a great example of this. Boy, that's fast. That was two notes on the B string. Switch after an upstroke. The pick is in the air. Then one powerful downstroke on the E string. That was alternate picking. And that was the power of downward pickslanting. He was an all-knowing, all-seeing architect of picking. Nothing about his technique was an accident. The licks he played were finely tuned to work within the parameters of his very carefully sculpted mechanics. And his mechanics were governed by a simple and unwavering set of rules about switching strings. And those rules, as I now knew them, went like this. 1. Use downward pick slanting at all times. 2. When playing a descending line, only switch strings after upstrokes. That was the Pop-Tarts technique. 3. If necessary, insert one pull-off to make an upstroke possible. That was the Black Star technique. 4. When playing an ascending line, switch strings after upstrokes when possible. That was one part of the Volcano technique. 5. When that's not possible and you must switch after downstrokes, use downward sweeping. That was the other part of the Volcano technique and the arpeggio technique. Realized that the ascending rules were special. When he went up, Yngwie could use any left-hand fingering he wanted. He would always have a way of using picking to get to the next string. If the last note on the string was an upstroke, he could use alternate picking, and downward pickslanting would take care of everything. But if the last note was a downstroke, he could use a sweep to push through to the next string. When combined, the possibilities were limitless. The incredible freedom to play any ascending line I wanted, almost without even thinking about the right hand, was truly astonishing. A great example of this whole system in action was this. Now this was cool because when he played it again, he did it with picking. So it was like a blueprint for transforming a legato lick into a picked one. And it was really two licks in one. The first part was a rolling pattern that Yngwie played in two positions. Now, what was cool about this little pattern is the way he connected the string changes. The first two notes went down, up, and then the fun started. He was about to end that string on a downstroke, and I knew that according to the rules, since he was ascending, he had to use sweeping. And there it was, the downward sweep that took him to the next string. Now, on this string, he was going to play five notes. 1, 2, 3, for... Wait a minute, where was the last note? Of course, if Yngwie had picked that last note, it would have been a downstroke. And I knew that according to the rules, that was no good because it wasn't clean. So instead, Yngwie used a pull-off. That's the index finger right there. This meant that the last picked note on the string actually was an upstroke, and I could see how perfectly this worked out. The pick was poised right above the B string, just waiting to drop. To finish off the pattern, he did two notes on the B string. And notice, this actually leaves out one of the notes. Ascending, it was originally three, but now it's only two notes on the B string. This clever omission forces the pattern to end on an upstroke. But this wasn't for string changing purposes, it was so he could start the pattern all over again, one position lower, on a downstroke. Down, up, there's the sweep, up, down, up, pull off, there's the string change, after an upstroke, of course, and then back to the B string for the final down, up. Perfect. In fact, because of the omitted note at the end of the pattern, each repetition would begin the same way as the last one, on a downstroke, and the picking structure for the entire rest of the pattern would be exactly the same. This pattern was such a clever way to connect different positions, I could even take it all the way down the neck if I wanted. Really cool. But that's not what Yngwie did. He mixed it up by connecting it to something which I was already pretty familiar with. The Black Star Lick. And the picking for the Black Star Lick was exactly the way I'd seen it the last time. Legato on the top string. Then four notes on the B string. Down, up, down, up with the slide, but picked just like last time. Then on the G string, down, up, pull off, just like before. Then the D string, down, up, pull off. You know, I could actually see he missed the first pick stroke on that string. No biggie. Then down on the A string. He was done. What a great little combination. Of course, traditional guitar instruction would never have told me to pick things this way. I mean, who really would have thought of limiting string switching only to upstrokes and rearranging all left-hand fingerings specifically to make things work out this way? And who really would have thought to play scales with sweeps in one direction and alternate picking in the other? And of course, who really would have thought to use a downward pick slant to make all of these things possible? The more I deconstructed these licks, the more I realized that Yngwie's technique went completely against conventional wisdom. But I had to ask myself, what good was conventional wisdom? I'd tried the conventional methods, and you know something? They didn't work. Sure, there'd been bright spots, but I could never tell when those bright spots were going to happen, and that wasn't confidence-inspiring. But now, within the space of one afternoon of stumbling upon pickslanting, I was able to play things I had previously only dreamed about. It was crazy to think this, but was it possible that downward pickslanting was actually the missing link that explained all those things I could never play? We'll be right back.